So vanoggend wil ek bedien oor iets wat vir ons hierdie jaar, jy gaan baie daaroor hoor, en dit is a culture of prayer. So binne in Kruislig het ons 'n paar goed wat ons sien in die skrif, en ons sê, maar hierdie moet deel wees van wie ons is, op grond van wat ons sien in die skrif, en wat God sê, hoe dit moet lyk, vir die wat hom ken, is een van die goed, dat ons moet mense wees wat bid, en wat baie bid, en wat aanhoudend bid. En ons noem dit a culture of prayer. Die skrif sê, ons is geroep om to be a people of prayer. In Thessalonicense, dit is 'n moeilike woord vir 'n Engelse persoon om uit te spreek, het ek dit reg? Daar sê, 5:17 sê, bid sonder ophou. Ons is geroep om te bid. Markus 11:15 sê, en hy het hulle geleer en vir hulle gesê, dit praat nou hier van Jesus, is daar nie geskrywe, my huis moet 'n huis van gebed genoem word, vir al die nasies nie. Jesus praat met sy disciples en hy sê, that is something that you should be known by. The people of God should be known as a people of prayer. It should be synonymous with who we are. That we're a praying people. That our house, that church should be a place where we pray. That's why Andre says often that ons doen net drie goed hier. We worship God, we pray, and we read the word. That's what we do. Because that's what we see in scripture, and that's what we see that God wants for us. It's interesting that after spending lots of time with Jesus, after seeing everything that Jesus did, the disciples ask him to teach them how to pray. And I was reading that verse and wondering and thinking, why would they not have asked something else? After seeing him raise the dead or multiply food or heal blind eyes or heal the sick, they come to him and they don't ask for those things. They don't say, sure, Jesus, teach us how to make the food more. Or Jesus, teach us how to raise the dead. Scripture records that they see something in the life of Jesus and this is their request. Teach us how to pray. We see you pray, Jesus, all the time. We hear you pray. We see you go away to pray. We see you pray for people. Jesus, teach us how to pray. That says something about the impression that Jesus made on them while he was with them on the earth, that they would ask that question, that they would say, teach us how to pray. Lukas 11 vers 1 sê, en toe hy op 'n sekere plek besig was om te bid, sê een van sy disciples vir hom, nadat hy opgehou het, Here, leer ons bid. Leer ons bid. They saw something in the life of Jesus and they recognized that prayer was so important to him. They see something and they say, sure, teach us to pray. They could have asked for lots of things, but they asked to be taught how to pray. And we're going to talk a bit about this morning because it is our highest privilege to go to God in prayer. Andre het bedien 'n paar weke terug oor die, is it the curtain? In Afrikaans die gordyn? Wat geskeur is, which gives us access to God, which gives us, affords us the privilege to come to God, to draw close to Him and to speak with Him. Scripture calls us a kingdom of priests. A priest was someone who would go to the people, hear what was necessary and needed, and then go to God and speak to him about it, and then go back to the people, hear what was necessary and needed, and then go to God and ask him for it. And scripture calls us all in the New Testament a kingdom of priests. It is our privilege and our responsibility to go to God in prayer often, to come before him. When something happens in our lives, wanneer iets skeefloop, dit is iets binne in die mens om na die hoogste gesag toe te gaan. Is dit nie so nie? Ek sien dit met my kinders. Wanneer iets gebeur en met klein kinders, my kinders is 5 en 8, ek hoor dit konstant. Konstant sê hulle vir my, mama, hy het my geslaan, hy het my gedoen. Hoekom doen hulle dit? Want hulle weet, die ma en die pa, dis die hoogste gesag. So dit is natuurlik vir hulle om te kom en sê, maar sort hierdie uit, doen iets hieroor. Ons as groot mense doen dit ook. Wanneer iets gebeur in ons lewens, iets skeefloop, iets fout gaan, dalk by die werk, wat doen ons? ons gaan na die hoogste gesag toe. Ons gaan na die baas toe en ons sê, hier is 'n probleem. Dalk gaan iets skeef by jou huis, hulle breek by jou in, jy gaan, wat doen jy? Jy bel die polisie, want dit is die gesag. Jy bel die hoogste gesag en jy sê, julle moet hierdie kom uitsort. En as Christene is dit ons absolute voorreg om na die hoogste gesag toe te kan gaan en te sê, Here, asseblief, U moet hier kom werk. You must bring change, God. Father, would you please work on our behalf? Would you please change the situation? Would you do something about where I find myself? Dit is ons absolute voorreg om na die hoogste gesag toe te kan gaan en te sê, Here, hier is my versoeke. Hier is wat ek nodig het. Hier is wat ek sien aangaan in my familie, in my lewe, om my, by die werk, met mense. Here, asseblief, ek weet U is in beheer. Ek weet U is die gesag. Sal U asseblief nie werk en iets doen? It's our privilege to go to God in prayer. If we're going to make prayer a priority in our lives, then we need a time, a place, and a plan. And we see in Scripture that Jesus had these things in place. Markus 1:35 sê, en vroeg in die môre, nog diep in die nag, ek weet jy wil nie dit hoor nie. Wie is die oggendmense wat vroeg kan opstaan en jy is vrolik en jy is bly en jy is gelukkig? Ek is nie daai persoon nie, ek hou nie van sulke skrifte nie, maar het sê vroeg in die oggend, het hy opgestaan en uitgegaan en na 'n eensame plek vertrek en daar gebid. We see that Jesus had a time when he prayed. Dit was sy gewoonte. Hy het 'n tyd gehad. En as ons nie 'n tyd het wanneer ons bid nie, dit is soos 'n afspraak, waar ons sê, maar hierdie is my tyd om te bid, dan gaan ons net eenvoudig nie bid nie. Wat om te bid vir die kos, om vinnig te bid in die kar, dit is nie verkeerd nie, dit is goed en dit is reg, ons moet dit doen, want die skrif sê, bid sonder ophou. Maar as ons nie 'n tyd het, wat ons uitsit en sê, maar in hierdie tyd gaan ek bid, ek gaan na die Vader toe gaan, dan gaan ons nie bid nie. En ons sien dat Jesus 'n tyd het, so ons moet ook 'n tyd het. Ek staan nie vroeg oggend op nie, Dit is nie goed nie, as ek dit probeer doen nie. So ek bid in die aand, dit is my tyd. As die kinders gaan slaap, as die huis stil is, as daar nie distractions is nie, almal het gaan slaap, daar's niemand wat gaan pla, dan gaan bid ek, dan gaan sit ek en bid ek. Dit is my tyd. Het jy 'n tyd wanneer jy bid, 'n afspraak met die Here, wanneer jy gaan sit en sê, môre weet ek, hierdie tyd gaan ek bid. As jy nie weet hoe laat gaan jy môre bid nie, daar's 'n goeie kans jy gaan nie môre bid nie. Dit is die ding. Wat is die tyd wat jy bid? Die skrif sê, Jesus het ook 'n plek gehad. Hy het na 'n plek toe gegaan om te bid. En dit is waar dat jy enige plek kan bid. Maar as jy 'n spesifieke plek het, wat jy weet, dit is waar ek bid, dit help met die distractions, om hulle af te sit. Dit help om voorbereid te wees, dat jy weet wanneer jy daar instap, wanneer ek in die studeerkamer instap, dan weet ek, hier is waar ek bid. My Bybel is daar, my gebedsbord is daar, daar's 'n pen daar, dit is stil daar, die kinders kom nie graag daar in nie. Ek weet, hierdie is my plek om te bid. En jou kop is soof ingestel as jy daar inloop en jy weet maar, hier's die plek waar ek bid. Soms bid ek in die tuin, daar's 'n hoek van die tuin, dit gooi my tor heeltemal af as ek dit skuif na 'n ander plek toe in die tuin. Dis vir my baie distracting, want dan moet ek eers myself soos vind daar en al die distractions en figure, ek weet nie of jy dieselfde is as ek nie, maybe you aren't. Maybe jy kan jouself so instel om enige plek te bid en dit is goed, maar dit help om 'n plek te hê en om te sê, maar ek het 'n tyd en ek het 'n plek en ek weet, daai tyd en daar, dis waar ek gaan bid. Dis waar, where I'm going to call on the name of the Lord, where I'm going to speak to Him about what's going on in my life. Dit help ook, as die plek is, 'n plek waar jy kan hardop bid, of hardop sing. So daarvoor moet jy beplan. Want jy kan nie dit noodwendig doen in 'n koffiewinkel nie. Mense dink dis vreemd. Jy kan nie dit daar doen nie. Jy moet 'n plek hê waar jy weet, maar hier kan ek bid. Ek maak die gordyne toe. Want as daar mense is buite, it's distracting. En dan kry ek myself, ek wil nie hardop praat nie, of ek wil nie hardop sing nie, want ons is maar mens, en dan dink jy, sjoe, iemand kyk dalk vir my, en wonder, wat maak sy daar binne, wat doen sy? Jy moet 'n tyd hê, jy moet 'n plek hê, en jy moet 'n plan hê. En Jesus het vir sy disippels 'n plan gegee vir gebed. En vanoggend, wat ek wil bedien is so eenvoudig, maar so kosbaar. Jesus gee sy disippels 'n plan vir gebed. In Matteus 6 en in Lukas 11, in twee plekke, hy vat hulle deur iets wat ons the Lord's Prayer noem. En het is so eenvoudig, maar het is so waardevol om te verstaan wat Jesus daar binnen gesê het vir ons. Matteus 6 van vers 9 sê, Jesus sê toe hulle vra, leer ons om te bid, hier is sy antwoord, so moet julle dan bid. Ons Vader, wat in die hemel is, laat die naam geheilig word, laat die koninkryk kom, laat die wil geskied, soos in die hemel, net so ook op die aarde. Gee ons vandag ons daaglikse brood, en vergeef ons skulde, soos ons ook ons skuldenaars vergewe. En lei ons nie in versoeking nie, maar verlos ons van die bose, want aan U behoort die koninkryk en die krag en die heerlikheid tot in ewigheid. Amen. Hierdie wat Jesus vir sy disippels leer, is nie iets wat ons bedoel was om net, sonder om te dink, net te herhaal. It wasn't meant to be a mindless repetition. He was giving them a model for prayer. As jy bietjie teruggaan in Matteus 6, 7, Jesus praat voor hy hierdie sê, en hy sê, en as jy bid, gebruik nie 'n ydele herhaling van woorde soos die heidene nie, want hulle dink dat hulle deur hulle baie woorde verhoor sal word. Ons is nie geroep na religion toe, waar ons net 'n klomp goed moet doen en sê, sonder om te dink en sonder dat ons harte betrokke is nie. Ons is geroep na verhouding. En so leer Jesus sy disippels om te bid. En hy gee vir hulle 'n model vir gebed. En hy sê, dit moet so lyk. En in my kop, hoe ek hierdie sien, dit is 'n klomp emmers wat Jesus vir hulle gee. En hy sê, wanneer jy kom, pak al hierdie emmers uit. En maak die emmers vol elke dag met jou gebede. Pak die emmers uit. En vanoggend gaan ons die emmers uitpak. En net deurpraat, wat is dit wat Jesus hulle eintlik geleer het? En die eerste emmer is die eerste sin wat hy praat. En hy sê, ons Vader wat in die hemel is. Our Father who art in heaven. Dit is emmer nommer 1. En hy sê, vat daai emmer as jy kom bid. Hierdie is die plan vir gebed. Vat daai emmer as jy kom bid en maak hom vol. Connect with God relationally. Thank Him for the fact that He is your heavenly Father. Recognize that you are in relationship with Him. Die skrif sê in Romeine 8:15 that we have been adopted as sons. So when you pray through this bucket, it might sound something like this. You pray and fill that bucket with prayers that say, Father, thank you that I'm your daughter. Thank you that I'm your son. Thank you that I've been adopted, that I'm part of the family, that I'm not coming to you as a stranger, God, but I'm coming to you as a child, to a father who loves me, a perfect, good father, like we sang this morning. Thank you, Father, that scripture says that Jesus, you were the firstborn among many brothers, and I'm just one of the family now, who comes the way that Jesus comes and speaks with freedom to the Father and asks Him for what I need. Dit is die eerste emmer. En Jesus sê vir sy disciples, wanneer jy kom, die eerste ding wat jy doen is, jy moet besef wie hy is vir jou. Want dan het jy selfvertroue om te kom bid en te kom vra vir wat jy nodig het. Want jy vra pa, jy vra nie 'n vreemdeling nie, jy vra nie 'n kwaai God nie, jy vra nie iemand wat ver is van jou af nie, jy vra pa. Want jy is in verhouding met hom en jy is sy kind. So maak daai emmer vol en bid en soek skrifte en bid dit deur en sê dankie Here dat ek die kind is. Dankie dat ek hier kan kom bid, hier kan kom sit vandag. Hier kan op my gesig kom lê. Ek weet nie hoe lyk dit as jy bid nie. Dankie dat ek hier kan op en af kom stap. Ek sien Mariet stap baie op en af in die park en sy bid. Wat ook al dit is, dankie Here dat ek hier kan kom bid en met my pa praat in die hemel. Die een wat in die hemel sit, wat bo alles is, wat regeer, die een wat gesag het in elke area. Dankie Here dat ek na U toe kan kom, maak die emmer vol. Ons Vader wat in die hemel is, maak daai emmer vol. Die tweede emmer is laat U naam geheilig word. In English it says, hallowed be your name. En daai tweede emmer, jy kan lank vat met hierdie emmer. En om vol maak with the praises of God. As you declare his name and who he is. I don't know if you remember what it was like to name your children. Wie het baie gestoei met hulle kinders se name? Mense, daar's 'n paar mense wat sê hulle baie gestoei met hulle kinders se name. Jy het dalk baie gebid en probeer 'n naam kies vir hierdie kind wat iets gaan beteken that has meaning attached to it. As ek nou baie eerlik gaan wees, toe ons name vir ons kinders gekies het, dit was nie baie geestelik nie. My eerste prioriteit met my kinders se name is was om seker te maak dat die naam nie de mekaar kan word tussen Engels en Afrikaans, want ek is Engels. So my naam is Deborah. Baie van julle noem my Debore en ek is vir jou lief, maar dit is nie my naam nie. So toe ons kinders name gegee het, ons het lank gesit en gesê, okay, hoe gaan 'n Afrikaanse persoon hierdie naam uitspreek? Want my man is Afrikaans, my familie is Engels. Hoe gaan die Engelse hierdie een uitspreek? Hoe gaan die Afrikaanse mense hierdie een uitspreek? Dan ons het dit getoets om seker te maak. Dis hoekom my eerste kind Ruben is, want Ruben is Ruben. Of jy nou Engels is of Afrikaans is baie geestelik, ek weet. Maar dis hoekom ons die naam gekies het. Ek wou net 'n naam gehad het wat nie verander kon word nie. Die tweede een het ons nie so goed gedoen nie. Ons het hom Zack genoem. Nou noem baie mense hom Zack. Dan sê ek soos nee. Dis nie sy naam nie. But anyway. Ons name het, dit het 'n betekenis. En as jy 'n nameboek vat en jy gaan kyk wat beteken jou naam, as jy 'n Christelike boek vat, gaan jy altyd iets moois kry en 'n skrif daarby kry en dit is goed en dit is wonderlik. Maar ek weet dat my naam sekere goed beteken. My naam beteken, een van die goed wat dit beteken is steady worker. Ek wil vir jou sê, ek is nie altyd 'n steady worker nie. Daar's 'n paar juffrouens en menere in die skool wat sal sê, nee. Dit beteken, een van die goed wat my naam beteken is courageous. Ek weet ek is nie altyd courageous nie. Soms is ek, soms is ek nie. Die ding met die name van God is dat sy name is 'n teentoonstelling van sy karakter, van wie hy is. En hy is altyd dit. So wanneer die skrif sê, wanneer Jesus sy disippels leer en hy leer hulle to say hallowed be your name, heilig is u naam. He's teaching them something. He's saying pray the name of God. Declare the name of God because he is always true to his name. He is always what his name says he is. In die skrif is daar meer as 650 name vir die Here. Dit is amazing. En ons gaan hulle nou deurgaan. Nee, grap. Ons gaan nie. Daar's 650 name vir die Here. And every single one of them is true all the time. It's always true. It's who he is. It's his character and it's his nature. So when Jesus says to the disciples, pray and say, holy is your name. They weren't meant to just go, holy is your name and move on. They were meant to sit and dwell on the name of the Lord. To go to scripture and say, God, what does scripture say who you are? And I want to read a few of them to you. I won't read all 650, but I will read a few of them to you. Jeremiah 23:6, one of the names that God has given is the Lord is my righteousness. Jeremiah 23 says, hy sal genoem word die Here ons geregtigheid. Jy kan daaroor bid en sê, Here, dankie dat u my geregtigheid is. Dit is wie u is. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. His name means he is my righteousness. And you can pray that and say, Father, thank you that you are my righteousness. Thank you that through the blood of Jesus, that I'm righteous because that's who you are and that's what you've done for me. Leviticus 20 verse 7 to 8, one of his names is the Lord who sanctifies me, the Lord who sets me apart, the Lord who makes me holy. The Lord who dedicates me, who separates me as a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people set apart, his own possession. You can pray through that and start to fill that bucket with his praises and say, thank you, Father, that you are the Lord who sanctifies me. The Lord, my peace. When Gideon encounters God in Judges 6, he has this encounter with God and he builds an altar, scripture says, and he calls the name of the place, the Lord, my peace. It's one of the names of God. And when Jesus came, Isaiah prophesies and says that he will be called Prince of Peace. He is our peace. It's interesting that when Gideon names God, the Lord, his peace, that he's in a war and he's on his way to war, but he's discovered something about who God is, and he praises God and he says, the Lord is my peace. And you might be in a fight, on your way to a fight, feeling like you're constantly in a fight, but it is true that God is the Lord my peace. It never changes. That's who he is. It doesn't change with the circumstances of our lives. He is the Lord my peace. And you can pray that and say, Father, thank you that you are the Lord my peace. Teach me, God, how to make peace, how to keep peace, how to have peace. Thank you, God, that you are a God of peace. Thank you that I have peace with you, Father. And because I have peace with you, you're teaching me to have peace with others. You can pray through the names of God. The Lord, my peace. The Lord who heals me is a name that God reveals to his people in Exodus. He says, this is what you will call me, the God who heals you. You can come and pray and say, thank you, Father, that your name means Jehovah Rapha, the one who heals. You are the God who heals me. Psalm 103, verse 1 to 3 says, Loof die Here, o my siel, en alles wat binnen in my is, sy heilige naam. Loof die Here, o my siel, en vergeet geen een van sy weldade nie. Wat al jou onregtigheid vergewe, wat al jou krankhede genees. You are the God who heals. We praise him for that. The Lord who provides for me. Genesis 22:14. It's one of his names. You are the God who provides. And you might be coming to pray because there are things that you need, but it is good to start with proclaiming who he is and say, Father, thank you that you are the God who provides. That's your name. The Lord, my banner. It means he's our victory. The Lord is my banner. The Lord, my shepherd. Psalm 23, the one we know well. The Lord is my shepherd. It's one of his names. The Lord, my help. The Lord, my inheritance. The Lord of hosts. The Lord is there. You know, that's one of his names. The Lord is there. Where? There. Wherever you need him, he's there. The Lord is there. He's ever present, ever existent. The Lord saves. That's the one that means Jesus. The Lord saves. When we call on the name of Jesus, that's what we're proclaiming. The Lord saves. The Master, the living God, the Anointed One, the Ancient of Days. The God who sees, the Mighty One, the Creator. God's names mean something. And when Jesus says to his disciples, Ek gaan jou leer hoe om te bid, bid so, sê heilig is u naam. Moenie vinnig deur daai gaan nie. Vat tyd, raak stil, begin sing. Lê op jou gesig en begin sê, Here, u naam is vrede. U naam is redder. U naam is die almagtige. U naam beteken iets. Spend time on who he is, on what his name is. Praise him for what he's done in your life. Thank him for the times in your life that those names have become a reality and true to you. And pray in faith and proclaim the names in faith that you haven't experienced yet. Because it doesn't mean that they're not true. It just means not yet. So if you are sick and you're saying, but Father, your word says that you're a healer, dan moet jy dit, then you must proclaim it and say, Father, but you are a healer. That's who you are. You are the Lord who heals me. That's who you are. I haven't experienced it yet, but you are the Lord who heals me. You are the Lord my peace. Maybe I don't experience it right now, but scripture says that is who you are. So I bring myself in line with who you are. I don't try and pull you into my circumstance and situation and say, oh, but that's not what I experience, or that's not what I feel right now. That's not what we do when we pray. We align ourselves with who He is. We declare His name. And we say, God, that's who Scripture says who You are. So that's what I'm going to proclaim. And if that takes me an hour, 2 hours, it doesn't matter. I'm praying. I'm going through the buckets. And I'm saying, God, this is who Scripture declares You to be. And if you read Scripture, you can go and find all the 650 others that Scripture says who He is. And you can start to pray those things, meditate on them, declare them, start to sing and praise Him and worship Him for who He is. It's worship. And Scripture teaches that the way that we approach God is with worship. Psalm 100 verse 4 says, enter into His gates with thanksgiving and come into His courts with praise. Try and begin to declare the names of God without worshiping. Without worshiping. You can't. It's impossible. When you start to declare who He is. When we come to God, it's so important that when we come to God in prayer, that the one we are coming to determines the approach, not the one who's coming. If I were to say to you today, I want you to come outside onto the stoop. I want you to meet Charles. You might think, great, who's Charles? Let me come with. Let me go meet him. But if I were to say to you, I want you to come outside on the stoop and I want you to meet King Charles III, the current reigning king of England, what would you do? You would start to check. Are you presentable? Are things in order? You would start to, you would approach differently. And when we come and pray, Jesus teaches His disciples to approach Him through declaring His name, because our approach changes when we begin to declare who He is. And that is what is required in prayer, that the one who we are approaching determines the approach. So He says, start this way. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Approach Him with praise, with worship, with recognition of who He is. That's how we must come in prayer. The third bucket that we must fill is laat U koninkryk kom, laat U wil geskied, soos in die hemel, net so ook op die aarde. Let Your kingdom come and Your will be done. Jesus teaches His disciples that when they pray, that they should prioritize God's priorities, that they should pray what is on God's heart and what is important to Him and what is close to His heart. That is how we should pray. That we should make what is important to Him important to us and pray through those things. That's what Jesus teaches in Luke 12:31, where He says, "Maar soek die koninkryk van God en al hierdie dinge sal vir julle bygevoeg word." Seek first the kingdom of God. So when we pray, we start to worship His name, to praise His name, to recognize that we're in relationship with Him. And then we begin to pray the kingdom into being. Pray what is important to Him. And I'm going to read you some things that are important to God, things that you can pray through. The first thing is praying for the lost. That's why we pray for people at the beginning of most services, for people who are unsaved. Because it's important to God. 1 Timothy 2 verse 1 to 4 says, therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So when we begin to pray in line with the kingdom, we pray for the lost. And I hope you have a prayer board that you have names of people on that you're praying for that are far from God. Because that's important to God, so it must be important to us. Next, we pray for wisdom and guidance for those in authority. Scripture teaches in 1 Timothy that we should pray for those in authority. So you can just start to pray and work through the president, the mayor of Rustenburg, the president of South Africa, those who are in authority in the place where you work, pray for them. Pray for the authority figures in the church. Pray for Andre. Pray for Marita. Pray for the elders. Pray for the cell group leaders. You can just start to pray for those in authority positions. Just start to pray through those things because God says that's important to Him. That's what He wants for us. Scripture teaches that what is important to God is the poor and the marginalized. It says it so often in the Bible. Jesus cares incredibly. God cares incredibly about those who are poor and marginalized. So that's something that we should pray. And say, Father, if I don't know someone, then I pray in general. But Father, if I know someone who's struggling, who's suffering, who is without God, then I pray. I begin to pray those things. Scripture says that we should pray about unity and love. It's something we should pray about. It's something that God cares deeply about. And what Scripture says should be something that the church should be known by. Scripture says that they will know that you are my disciples by the way that you love one another. Maybe you haven't been in church very long, but if you've been in church long enough, you'll know that unity and love is hard in church. Nobody nod now. Otherwise, the people next to you are going to wonder. But all of us have to fight for this in prayer and say, God, help me. Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, Paul writes in Ephesians 1-3, and he explains the mystery of the gospel. He speaks about the wonderful grace of God that saves us. Ephesians 1-3, and he paints this incredible, beautiful picture. And then Ephesians 4:5-6, he explains what the outworking of that mystery of the gospel is on us, the church. And what he says is, maintain the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That is hard. Even if it's your first day in church, there's probably a good chance that you walked in here this morning and you saw somebody and your eyes raised and you thought, sure, someone kijk wat ze type kerk is hierdie. Because it's difficult. But God says it's dear to his heart that we pray about this, that we pray about unity, that we pray about peace, and we work it through in our prayer life, that we fight for it on our knees, that we don't get to a place of deception where we just say, phew, dis so moeilik, ek gaan net die Here praat met my, ek gaan net by die huis alleen die Here dien, sonder kerk en sonder mense. Daar doen ek baie goed met 1 Korintiërs 13, daar is ek sagmoedig en langmoedig en ek is kind en ek is patient, want daar is niemand om my nie, ek doen baie goed. Ons kan nie dit doen nie. Ons moet bid en veg vir hierdie en sê, Here, help ons. If you know of someone in church who's struggling within this area, pray for them. If it's you, it's probably you, pray for yourself and say, Father, help me. Help me to prioritize your word, to honor you. This is one of the names of God. The Lord is peace. So we should be a people of peace. We should be a people of unity, a people of love, because it's who he is. So it's something we have to fight for. We can't just leave it and say, "Ooh, nee, skip here." It's unassailable. We must pray it through. We must pray about justice. God says it's important to him. Pray about justice. Pray for freedom for people who are in bondage, who are stuck in sin or some other form of bondage. Pray for people. Pray that his purposes would be accomplished in our lives. Pray. This is praying that his kingdom would come. Praying for the things that are important for him. Ek gee 'n Bybelklas by Baarsig elke donderdag. En ons het 'n rukkie terug hieroor gepraat. En ek het hulle gevra om groepe te maak. En toe vra ek die vraag, waar is die koninkryk van God? Waar is dit? En 99% van hulle na 'n klomp groepgesprekke het gesê, dit is in die hemel. En toe sê ek, maar dit is nie so nie. Dit is nie wat die skrif sê nie. Hoekom dan, so Jesus sy disippels geleer het om te bid en gesê, laat u koninkryk kom hier op die aarde, soos in die hemel. Die koninkryk van God is waar God heers. The kingdom has come where the king reigns. So Jesus teaches his disciples to pray that into being. To fight for it in prayer and pray it into being and say, God, let your kingdom come here on earth as in heaven. Because the kingdom is where the king reigns. So if the kingdom reigns, if the king rules and reigns in your life because you are submitted and obedient to his word, that's where the kingdom is. Then it's true that the kingdom has come where you are if the king reigns. Die volgende emmer wat ons moet volmaak is vers 11 waar hy sê, gee ons vandag ons daaglikse brood. En hier is die gedeelte van die gebed waar ons bid vir wat ons nodig het. for our needs, for our problems, for the issues in our lives where we can come and pray and lay them at God's feet. I was reading a book recently where the writer wrote and he said, only one person can hold your problems. It's either you or it's God. And in prayer, we have an opportunity to bring them to God and hand them over to Him and lay them at His feet and say, Father, I'm struggling with this. I have an issue with this. We can bring our needs and issues. And you can see how that bucket would be filled in different ways every day. That's why you can pray through this model every day, and it'll sound different every day, because every day it will be something different in each of these buckets that you're praying through. So he says to them, pray through your problems, your needs, and your desires. Psalms 121 vers 1 en 2 sê, ek slaan my oë op na die berge, waar sal my hulp vandaan kom? My hulp is van die Here wat hemel en aarde gemaak het. The writer of this psalm recognizes that God is the authority figure. So he calls out to him in trouble and says, come and help. You can call to lots of people to help you, but the best thing that you can do is call to the one who is above all, who is in authority, to call to the one who rules and who reigns, the one for whom nothing is impossible, and say, Father, would you help me? Would you work on my behalf? We bring our problems, our needs, and our desires. Then verse 12 says, die volgende emmer wat ons moet volmaak, is vergeef ons skulde, soos ons ook ons skuldenaars vergewe. Forgive us, Lord, for our sins. Scripture teaches that every day we need to come to God and say, search my heart. See if there's anything in me that's displeasing to you, God. Psalm 139, David writes and he says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Prayer shapes us, and this is how. When we come before God and we begin to pray and we begin to ask and say, Father, show me, maybe I know, there's things that I know about. So I confess those things to God, and then He's faithful and just to forgive us. But prayer shapes us when we begin to sit and pray and we begin to ask and say, Father, would you show me if there's something in my life that's displeasing to you? And then He starts to speak and He says, yeah, that. The way you spoke there, the way you responded there. Then prayer starts to shape us. And we get up and we leave our time of prayer different than when we walked in. Prayer is meant to shape us. And it shapes us through this part of the prayer. When we start to pray through the things that we need forgiveness for, the things that are out of line with what God wants and desires for us. And then the second part is that we begin to forgive and release others. Because Scripture says that we need to keep a short list with people. That's how we maintain the unity and the bond of peace. We keep a short list. 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter says, love keeps no record of wrongs. How do you do this? Well, you get to pray with your list of what people have done to you, and you deal with it. And you say, Father, they did this, they said this, they acted like that, they made me feel like this. And you release those things to God. You forgive. Jy spreek vry, jy praat met die Here, jy deel met jou hart, en jy loop sonder daai lys. Die lys is klaar, die lys is weg, die goed is doodgetrek, dis opgevrommel, dis meer gedeel. We leave without the list as we forgive those who've sinned against us. Dit is nodig in die koninkryk. Hebreërs 12 vers 14 en 15 sê, jaag die vrede na met almal en die heiligmaking waar sonder niemand die Here sal sien nie. En pas op dat niemand in die genade van God verachter nie, dat geen wortel van bitterheid opskiet en onrus verwerk en baie hierdeur besoedel word nie. Dit is baie makliker om onkruid uit te trek wanneer het klein is, as wanneer het groot is. Vir die wat julle, for those of you who were here at the park day, it's easy to pull out the small weeds, the small offenses when they've just sprung up. It's easy to pull them out. It's difficult to pull out the big weeds. Daai wat al klaar soos bome lyk, dis moeilik. Jy kort 'n groot vurk en jy moet sterk wees om daai uit te kry. So Jesus teaches his disciples and says, every time you come and pray, come and keep the list short. Pray those things through. Get them out of your heart. Do some weeding. Sit with me in my presence and deal with those things. Ask for forgiveness and extend forgiveness to those who need it. Die volgende emmer is, en lei ons nie in versoeking nie, maar verlos ons van die bose. Efesiërs 6 vers 12 sê, want ons worstelstryd is nie teen vlees en bloed nie, maar teen die owerhede, teen die magte, teen die wêreldheersers van die duisternis, van hierdie eeu, teen die bose geeste in die lig. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, scripture says. So you don't come and fight with people in your prayer time. You come and deal with your heart and say, Father, help me. Deal with the stuff in me. Deal with what is an issue for me. Scripture says, teaches that Jesus says to his disciples, when you pray, pray and ask God to help you with your temptations. Because we all know the areas that we're weak in. We know what they are. And it is wise to come and sit with God and to pray through those things regularly and say, Father, I know that I struggle in this area. Would you help me, God? Would you give me wisdom, things that I need to put in place, things that I need to do so that I don't fall into this thing, so that I don't get tripped up by this thing? Because we know what our temptations are. We know the areas where we struggle. And Scripture says that we should pray and we should deal with those things in our times of prayer. That is where the fight happens. It happens on our knees where we say, Father, would you help me? Would you make me into one who looks like you? Would you change me? Would you deal with these things that are deeply rooted in my heart, this bent that I have to go one way, whatever it is, whether it's a sin, an addiction, a personality trait that is, we say it's a personality trait, but it's out of line with the character of God, whatever it is, that we would pray through those things and say, Father, help me. Help me with this area in my life. Pray it through. Ask God to show you the lies that you're believing and ask Him to replace the truth in your life. Pray and say, Father, would you show me if there are areas in my life where I'm believing a lie, believing something about you or about your people or about myself that isn't true, that's leading me a certain way, that's drawing me away from what you have for me, would you show me, God, and deal with that thing? I think we all walk around with some lies, with some things that we believe that are out of line with Scripture. It's almost like something that we go back to, and everything that happens in our life, then we go, ja, jy sien, ek het geweet, dit is hoe dit is. We need to pray through those things and say, Father, help me. Would you remove this thing from my life? This default that I have, this lie that I default to, that I know isn't true, I know it's out of line with your word, but in me it just constantly keeps coming up. Pray through those things. Die laaste emmer is die laaste gedeelte van die gebed wat sê, want aan u behoort die koninkryk en die krag en die heerlikheid tot in ewigheid. En hierdie laaste gedeelte van die gebed, die laaste emmer wat ons volmaak, nadat ons deur al hierdie gebid het, is that we express faith in God's ability. Jeremiah 32, Jeremia 32, 17 sê, ach Heere, kyk, U het die hemel en die aarde gemaak deur die grote krag en deur die uitgestrekte arm. Geen ding is vir U te wonderbaar nie. What a beautiful scripture. When we pray, yours is the kingdom, we're saying, God, all authority belongs to you. When we pray, yours is the power, we're saying, Father, all might flows from you. You are strong and mighty. You are able to do all that I have brought to you and prayed about. Yours is the glory. Your victory is complete. The battle is won. I know how the story ends. Even if I've been wrestling through this time of prayer, because there are things I'm still working out in my life. The scripture says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And sometimes, dit is 'n stoei, waar jy probeer goed uitsort in jou lewe, jy probeer vrede najaag met mense en heiligheid. Dit is 'n stoei soms, but we know the end. We know the end of the story. That the end of the story is that one day, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. That in the end, the battle is already won. That God has overcome. Jesus rules and reigns. That is the end. So Jesus teaches his disciples and he says, when you pray, close your prayer like this. Say, thank you, Father. That after all of this, after all this wrestling in prayer, after everything I've asked, after everything I've spoken to you about, God, I know how it ends. I maybe don't see it yet, but yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory, God. Thank you, Father, that everything is yes and amen in Christ. That I know the things that I have prayed for and brought before the Father, that he hears, that he sees, and that he acts on my behalf.